Doing pretty well.
Functional.
I'm happy to be here with you, my friend.
It's great to see you too, man. It's great to see you. When was the last time you were actually out here in the UK?
That's a good question. It must have been when we were touring, 2009, something like that.
Wow. It's been a minute. You've been busy in between, but you're back with this new record, Hesitation Marks. In fact, yes. Let me just blow your mind altogether and take you further back. What was your first impression when you first ever came to the UK with Nine Inch Nails, you know, on a sort of creative basis?
First time was recording Pretty Hate Machine. That would have been 1988, I think. Maybe 89, actually. I was dropped off by myself, staying in Islington. And it was weird. The beer tasted funny.
This is why you always got to be really nice to Trent Reznor, because he has this like elephant style photographic memory of everything. So.
No, I had fun though, I enjoyed being here.
Well, it's good to have you back. Hesitation Marks is the brand new album due out very, very soon, September the 2nd. Is that still the whole date?
No idea.
Good to see you keeping up with the modern day promotional requirements of the musician. He's old school, ladies and gentlemen. He doesn't even know when the record's coming out. I haven't heard an artist say that for about 5 years. No idea. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the touring you've been doing. Everything is up to date as possible, you know. And it's sort of, can we address the elephant in the room? Can we just get straight with the question a lot of people want to know, which is apparently there was some issue at Pukkelpop. Do you want to address that? Or are people looking into it too seriously?
The issue that we sucked?
What it was?
No, it was weird. We just played a bunch of shows, not a bunch of shows, but a handful in Asia and in the States. And it felt like a triumph, you know, when we came out at Pukkelpop. And I think, it was during daylight. And I've built this show that I think is pretty impressive.
We're going to talk about it. I think it's spectacular.
But it's not that impressive with the sun out.
Right.
You know, so it felt like a puppet show, Spinal Tap situation a little bit. No, we were in front of a crowd that was Eminem's crowd.
Right.
You know, I like Eminem, but I don't know that his crowd necessarily was ready for what we were pulling on them. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. It was a weird kind of, humbling experience.
That's the festival experience. It can be so hit and miss, right? I mean, when you're doing your own shows, you can control it. You can be in charge of the way things are, the timings of things. You know, you're in a fortunate position for the most part because you get to play at night and you do get to headline a lot of festivals. So, you know, it must come as a surprise when those kind of circumstances don't work in your favor in a way.
No, I mean, you're right. That's part of what playing the whole festival thing is. And, you take the good with the bad.
And you've had a lot of good. Can I talk about the live show, man? Because the first time I saw footage of you guys performing in Fuji, I was blown away by the pace of it, by the bravery of it as well. I mean, for you to look, you're known for performing amazing music with the setting to match. You've put a lot of effort throughout your whole career from the early days up to now of making sure that the live show is astounding and breaking boundaries. And yet this time you come on with one light and no instruments and no band.
Well, it was the way this came about. When I started working on the record, and eventually a conversation turns to, do you think you'd like to tour to support it? Maybe, let's see. The tour is supposed to start this fall in the States in arenas. So we've been building for the last year and a half or so this pretty elaborate show based on an environment you come into that we've created that's kind of something we're proud to reveal that you haven't seen yet. Then I start to see festival shows popping up and, hey, what about this one? Okay. What about this one and this one? And then I realized that there's a number of pretty high-profile shows we have to present the band, and the band hasn't been around for a while, and we're going to be debuting new material. And the presentation means a lot to me. And I think generally rock shows can be pretty lazy, and if you have people's attention, why not try to exploit that best you can and really make it the coolest thing you can. So we spent the that inserted a whole new workload of trying to design a show that works in a festival environment.
A second show. Pre-show in a weird way.
A show on top of the show.
come on.
Anyway, I'm really pleased with the way it came out.
It's amazing.
It's an awful lot of work to get it to function.
It reminds me, I know this is an obvious statement because you probably clarified this already in talking to people, but it does remind me of Stop Making Sense, of that reveal, of that moment where it's like you break it all down to its basic level of performance, which is one man on a stage with one lamp, and then let's build it.
Yeah, that was certainly an influence. You know, I had the pleasure of finally meeting David Byrne, and I've been a lifelong Talking Heads fan. And I'd been thinking about, for some reason, I've thought about that film, which I hadn't seen for years. Mm-hmm. Stopped making sense. And I went back and watched it again. It was way better than I even remember it being. And I highly recommend anybody listening, if you want to see a great concert film, check out Stop Making Sense. Fantastic.
Not to make it about me, but I went. Yeah. I made my mum take me to that two nights in a row when it came out when I was a kid. Because I'd never seen anything like it. I mean, up to that point, I was always used to seeing rock shows. Like, I think the first show I ever went to was Kiss. To go and see theatrics on a completely different level.
Yeah. Really
were you smart. A Kiss fan?
I was a huge Kiss fan back in the day.
Clearing that up. Not a big fan of what they've done in the last 20 years?
No. They played a large role in my development, for better or for worse, you might say.
If we were talking to key fans now before we get into a track, could you sort of describe the two or three other single most important influences for you as a young music fan growing up that now, with the benefit of hindsight and all the music you've created and being that for others, you can really sort of narrow it down now to say two more on top of Kiss after that auspicious start?
You know, Kiss for me, and this is growing up in a rural nowhere in America, away from college radio and lots of artistic influences, but Kiss to me hit me at a time when... something that was larger than life and felt dangerous, which it did back then context. You know, that felt like an escape. That was a way out of this little town I was in, and a way to, even if it was just in imagination, you know, daydreaming. That was important to me. You know, I spent a lot of time after that with Pink Floyd in headphones, you know, appreciating the fact that these rich English guys somehow could speak to me. High school kid sitting in Pennsylvania.
And also, as a future producer, someone to be able to listen to music made like that, not just riffs and big sounding drums, but layers.
No, for sure. That crept into my brain as ways to do things. And I'd say a few years later, being put on the spot, exhausted, trying to come up with key influences
in my entire life. That's my job.
You know, I'll refer back to David Byrne. I think when I heard Remain in Light, Talking Heads album. It confounded me. I couldn't make sense of it. I didn't understand what I was hearing, but I chose to keep listening. And 10 listens in, it started to reveal itself. And 50 listens in, you know, it became something that really made my brain larger and opened me up to possibilities. And still to this day is something I listen to quite often as a kind of production manual in terms of polyrhythmic way things.
But it's hip hop as well. That's what's amazing about it is it's not just disco and new age, but it's hip hop. Where's that track? Is it this one has the best drum beat ever?
A classic. You know?
I mean, that just sounds like that's incredible, right?
First couple songs on that record, I still listen to trying to figure out what is the bass doing. What's happening?
But I mean, they hold on a groove and yet they make it sound like it's some kind of opus. Like, I mean, just talking about Cross-Eyed and Painless, which is a dance record.
Yeah.
But it's unbelievable melodically as well. Just like, so great. Do-do-do-do.
I like the speed at which you just called that up out of the air.
All of us can be as slow as you, mate. You know. Trent Reznor, Nine Inch Nails, with us tonight on Radio 1. You know this came back haunted from Hesitation Marks.
We'll be right back.
came back haunted from the forthcoming new album called Hesitation Marks. Trent Reznor is live in the studio right now on Radio 1 with us for another 20 minutes or so. People are tweeting in very quick succession. The most commonly asked question is, Trent, can you have a guess what people want to know? UK related?
I can't imagine.
Yeah, I wonder when that will be happening, the Can't Imagine tour. We'll get to that at some point, but people are desperate to know if you're going to come out and do a tour in earnest. So I'll let you think about that for about 15 minutes or so and drop it on you at the end.
Okay.
Let's talk about Hesitation Marks. You know, we've already discussed on the phone that the break you took was necessary for you to focus on other things and just pursue other parts, just live a life outside of being in Nine Inch Nails and being in the band. But when did you first get that that kind of feeling that you wanted to make music as Nine Inch Nails again with whoever it might be?
You know, I was working on music the whole time with David Fincher on the films and also with How to Destroy Angels, which we'd been working on pretty much since the end of Nine Inch Nails in 2009 up through the whole process. And those two experiences really taught me a lot about collaboration. And by not having to be the boss and not having to be the supreme leader that everything has to filter through and have to make every judgment call. It was a revitalizing experience, you know, and it made me kind of appreciate, once the itch started, to say, well, if I were to put myself back in center stage and start writing for my own voice, for my own personality, it felt like a more ripe situation to do that. It felt exciting to me about a year and a half ago or so. Started messing around with a couple songs just to see what would happen with the stakes being nothing, you know. And
good secret. You kept that good.
Yeah, I've learned over the years that it's nice to hold back things until you have something to actually, you know. Nothing's more boring than, hey, this song I'm going to write, man, it's going to be great. You know, let me finish it. So things just progress. A couple songs started. The first couple that I wrote on this record were Everything and Satellite. Then I called up Alan Mulder and Atticus Ross and said, hey, let's book some time if you have time and see what happened. And it took a lot longer than we thought, in a good way. And it was a really interesting process, you know, fun and hard at the same time.
Mm. With that break, you could have, as you have in the past, you could have taken Nine Inch Nails into any territory that you felt was appropriate for what that is. And it's very broad. I mean, you have your collection of records as Nine Inch Nails is, you know, very across the board in terms of feelings and emotions and vibes and songs and sounds. So actually narrowing it down to something, to giving it a personality, was that a challenge?
I think the only real directive I started with was focusing on songs, you know, and getting away from expansive instrumental works, and that would be a reaction to Ghosts and also the soundtrack work I'd just done. Mm. Trying to think in terms of concise songwriting, melodies, lyrics, message. When I started messing around, I found unexpectedly that working off a laptop and more beat-oriented, less real instruments, very little guitar, live drums didn't seem that interesting. I did a few things and it just kind of felt boring. I was much more excited about things with a rhythmic element to it for whatever reason. It wasn't a conscious decision. So everything started as demos on kind of beatbox. And then when I brought them downstairs to work with the rest of the guys, another rule kind of appeared, which was it felt like I needed to try to keep it as sparse and minimal as possible. Which was a fairly new concept. In the past, it had been layering and layering, and I have all this stuff. Let me keep making this tapestry of sound. And this time I thought, let me try to only put in what really has to be there.
Were you conscious when that, when you were creeping into that old habit? Or did Atticus or someone remind you and go, you know what, you're just starting to build this up again?
No, it was my directive coming down and saying, let's keep it as sparse as we have to. Let's really see what happens. And there came a point where we were really questioning, do these just sound like demos or do they sound like finished tracks, or should we, what would happen if we went and arranged them with real drums and full instrumentation, or tried it as a Beatles-esque kind of arrangement versus.
Did you try it?
We did.
Wow.
A number of the tracks we re-recorded and, you know, I won't say wasted time, but we went down different paths to see what the result was.
Just confirmed that you were on the right path, I guess.
For the most part, we stayed on the path we instinctually felt was right, which was this more minimal electronic kind of based thing. And, you know, we wound up with a record that, that the three of us felt very positive and very, very confident that was a well-written step forward. And that was really the other big thing that I was concerned about is, you know, my fear is, I never want to rely on nostalgia, you know, and I never want to be too self-referential to the point where I feel like, am I emulating myself in a way that feels like I'm phoning it in? You know, does it not feel like a challenging and frightening step forward? And when that moment comes where I think that it's, it feels like it's getting into that, then it's time to stop this. It's time to do it under a do something different. You know?
I was thinking about hesitation marks the other day, actually, and what struck me, and you may, I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong, but this must be one of, if not the first Nine Inch Nails album that you've made that hasn't been mired in some kind of either professional, business, or personal headache, to put it mildly. You know, with something's going on, be it you're leaving a label or you're going through your own personal struggles or whatever, something's going, you know what I mean?
I'm so, adding things, kids, labels.
But these are all, but these are things of harmony and control, aren't they? These are things that you are building for yourself as opposed to being at the mercy of others. Did that have an impact on the record?
It's possible. I hadn't really thought about that. You know, this was, what felt different about this process was I think through confidence allowed myself to get out of the way. You know, like I can tend to be very editorial to a point where it's fear-based. You know, I'm afraid I can't try that because that may be out of the wheelhouse of Nine Inch Nails. And I, you know, it needs to sit under this column that's very rigid. You know, even though I try to keep that as expansive, there's still another voice in me that's saying, you know, you don't want to be judged by people. You know, you don't want to, it's not cool enough to do it this way or that way. You know, and this time I really kind of got out of the way and let me just go with gut. Let me go with just what feels instinctually right. And save that editorial moment to the end. When I did, there was a few things, and a song I believe we're debuting tonight was one that almost was thrown out.
Go on with the segue. You know it's coming next. Go on with the segue.
See, it's almost like we rehearsed this, but we didn't.
We didn't.
You know? No, this is one that I would have not put this on because it felt too obvious. And I would have questioned that. In fact, I did question it at some point in this record when the record started to take shape with all the other tracks. But at the end, I thought, this is a really strong track, and I think it complements the rest, and I'm not afraid to try it.
You are as God made you.
That's right.
Ladies and gentlemen, the aforementioned record from Nine Inch Nails worldwide exclusive from our album of the week, Hesitation Marks, out according to us on September the 2nd. This is Everything. I survived.
I'm not afraid to try. I am home. I believe I am home. I am free. I am home. I can see always here. I am home.
That's a worldwide exclusive. I always love to say that when I'm playing my favorite music. That's Nine Inch Nails and everything taken from the forthcoming new album called Hesitation Marks. And I think, judging from what I've heard of the record, which is maybe 4 or 5 songs off the record so far, I think that fits, you know, imperfectly in the way that it works, you know?
Thank you very much.
Trent Reznor is our guest tonight for about another 7 or 8 minutes. I'm going to throw it out there to Twitter. If anybody's got any really amazing questions they want to ask Trent, we'll do that in this last part. Uche, can you keep across at BBCR1? That's the Twitter handle, at BBCR1. And if we'll let Uche be the man. If any really jump out for you or James, just fire them over to me before the end. So, Trent, lots of things have been going on in and amongst music in between Nine Inch Nails records, and you know, you've been instrumental in being across many of them, and I know that you keep your ear across a lot of things outside of just music. You are fascinated with the machine, aren't you? With the way things operate and the way things work.
Yeah, yeah.
Has it always been the case, as long as you can remember, that you wanted to know how to build it as well as use it?
I think so. You know, as my brain started working again, I'm intrigued by trying to solve problems, you know, when they come up, whether it be, and I can get sucked into that, you know, whether it be marketing my record, figuring out how to get it to you, the fan, in a way that feels appropriate for both parties, or whatever it might be, you know, dealing with them. See, I'm trying to read your mind of what you're segueing into right now.
No, please tell me.
Right now, I'm trying to figure out how his laptop is working and why he's looking at what seems to be nude pictures of men on there.
It's because I'm handsome Dan, you know, from the Wayans. I'm like, but it's worked for you, that whole side of it. And it hasn't cost you the music. It doesn't feel like you're sacrificing one for the other. And I think a lot of your fans love the fact that you are looking that deeply into things and you're looking at music beyond your own as well, and ways that it sounds and ways that people can get it. I know you've obviously been involved in the setting up of and the, you know, the stages of this new service for people to get music. And, you know, I just find it interesting that you balance the two out, and it must be kind of challenging in a way.
Well, I think being someone that makes music and having spent the last 20 some years in the record business gives me a perspective that the tech community doesn't quite have, and the record label side of things I don't think has. And also, generally approaching everything from what it feels like as a fan, you know, what pretty much everything Nine Inch Nails does, I try to look at it through the eyes of the interested fan party, you know, who's attending that show. What do they feel like? What would they like? You know, because that's always how I've always seen myself, as that guy.
You still are the guy, right, in middle America who's such a fan of those records, who's going,
it's,
you know,
still me. No, but I think that someone's got to figure this out. You know, I think the record industry, the music industry, is in between business models, and I know as a fan what I feel shortcomings are about how you discover music, how you find music, how you purchase it, or how you listen to it, or experience it, or share it. And I also know how frustrating it is as a musician to be on the other side of it. You know, where something you've dedicated your life to is now something most people think should be a free service to people. I get it. I get on both sides of it, and I think it's an interesting problem that I'm trying to contribute the solution to a solution.
Well, you know, unsurprisingly, some of the questions that are coming in already, and I've got a couple in front of me here in related to future technology and things like that. This one from Higher Beck says, would you consider venturing into a Nine Inch Nails virtual reality project now that technology is coming of age? And are you, you know, across things like that, and how far would you want to push into that world? And it, I suppose for my addition to that question is anything too weird to work on, you know?
I don't have any great answer for that. You know, I think I'm interested in new ways to present music. I'm interested in new experiences one could have. Like what I thought we did with Year Zero in terms of a kind of transmedia presentation of a story across different platforms was interesting. Mm-hmm. You know, it was very rewarding from a creative point of view. But at the same time, I think it has to have integrity and feel like something that isn't just a tech demo or isn't just a thing just to exist. You know, if it still can have an emotional resonance with the person experiencing it, then it has some level of interest to me.
This from John Haywood, and this is a really tough one on the spot, especially with 2 hours sleep, but maybe something will pop into your head. Who was the last new or newish band to catch your attention or artist that you really, really enjoy?
It wouldn't matter if I had 200 hours of sleep. Somehow that question is like a mind eraser.
I know, that's tough.
Well, Mary Queen and I have listened to Disclosure a lot.
There you go.
I think it's a really great album.
Collaboration. How do you feel about collaboration? Not to suggest that you would want to work with anybody in particular or them, but how do you feel about collaboration or producing others or things like that?
I'm probably more open to it now than I've ever been. And that's me being comfortable with myself and being able to interface with people better. And mm-hmm. that's working around my own neuroses and sense of being insufficient. You know, being able to kind of put that in perspective. You know, I learned a lot from working with Fincher. And I mainly learned how things could be a lot better when you have a lot of other great people around you and you can bounce ideas off of them. The same thing I've learned, you know, quite honestly, with the two guys I've collaborated the most, Atticus Ross and Alan Moulder. Strangely, both British people.
I'd say you're welcome, but I can't claim that.
Between that and also working with Mary Queen on How to Destroy Angels, it made me realize that that moment when you exchange an idea and it comes back better than it was just out of your own head.
It's nice to let go. Yeah,
there's a lot of things I actually like to do collaboratively now, and I'm already formulating the next couple years of my life.
You can give us one of them.
Dot dot dot. I can't give it away.
Did you just right dot now. Dot dot me?
Shh.
Oh, you're not. That comes with an in-joke, but I'll let you get away with it. This one from Graham, a couple more. Plans for a live DVD. The pro shot footage from 2009 has been expressed on my Twitter timeline was so brilliant. I watched so much of it as it came through. Any thoughts of kind of doing that off this new tour?
Well, here's what I've just realized is, you know, we're playing, I don't know, 14 festival shows, I think, before the real tour starts in September. And I think 10 of them have been webcast or will be webcast.
It's on YouTube anyway, right?
So it's there, you know, it's there in a true way where we haven't been able to fix anything. And I'm aware of that live, that camera's floating around, and I'm not just playing with the people in the.
Oh, that must be pretty horrible at times.
It adds a new layer of anxiety, let's put it that way. But those things are out there, and I would highly recommend if you're interested in our show now, just there's a thing called Google. If you put in the word Nine Inch Nails live.
Other search engines are available. I mean, do you even say that these days? UK tour, the most often asked question this evening since I announced that you're going to be joining us on the show. Jim, can we say it? Yeah, you said we can say it. April, did I get that right? I don't want to get the month wrong.
I'm hearing this for the first time. Oh, we are?
Hey, congratulations, Trent. We'll see you in April. Cool.
Real tour coming up.
With the real new production and everything attached.
Real as in all the trimmings.
Can't wait. Trent, really good to see you as always. Thank you for popping by. I know, you know, 2 hours sleep, but...
I appreciate you having me.
Good luck this weekend.
Thank you.
And Nine Inch Nails. It's great to have them live in the studio. Just announced an April 2014 tour for the band throughout the UK. That answers the most requested question of the evening. Fans want to know April next year for Nine Inch Nails. Hold tight, we've got the hottest record repeat coming up in a second.